प्रोफेसर नीरव एलजी इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी. तो वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस टेक कॉल्ड ऑटोमोबाइल कंपोनेंट. दिस सेशन इज अबाउट डिजाइन ऑफ इट्स डिजाइन प्रोसेस. सो बिफोर गेटिंग इनटू दिस डिजाइन प्रोसेस लेट्स टॉक अबाउट आवर प्रीवियस टॉपिक ऑफ हाउ दिस कनेक्टिंग नोड algorithm function has been set. Material selection, manufacturing process, we have gone through that. So now we will set up the procedure to designing this connecting. So to design this connecting rod, our first step is to understand what this connecting rod is and what kind of different dimension we are going to do. So connecting rod is a connecting component between piston and crankshaft. And it is also subjected to buckling loop because it is a structural part, or you can say it is a part which is considered as a short bolt. So there are mainly a four section we are going to design. One is dimension of cross section of the connecting rod. As you can see here, the shank part, or you can see there, here you can see it is the shank part, or this is the part which we are going to we are talking about. This dimension of your crank cross section area, then dimension of the crank pin at a big end. This is the big end. You can see here, this is the big end. So dimension of this big end, then dimension of dimension at small end, which is also pin dimension. So after setting up a dimension of design, this big end and small end, after that we are going to determine size of this bolt which is connected to this big end with our body, because this big end is mainly a disconnected. You can say there are multiple parts. One is its cap. This area from this separating line here, this area from this separating line is called big end cap. Here this is called bolts. These are the bolts which are subjected to a crushing or shear stress. Are subjected to shear stress, which we have previously talked about. Here this big end is subjected to bending stress here, and the small end is subjected to bending stress and crushing stress. So here in this case of this hole is also comes under crushing. And after this we are going to design thickness of this big end cap here. So mainly we are going to design this connecting rod in four parts. One is its cross section at its shank. Another is dimension of the crank pin at a big end and small end here, and then a design of that bolts is connected our big end with our body, and then thickness of the big end. So these are our mainly procedure of design. Now we are going to get into design of this different section in one by one. So first our design is about this cross section area of our connecting rod. So cross section area is mainly a I section. Here you can see it's a I section. Here, so in this I section, its thickness, which is upper part and lower part, is called flange, and the center part, which is connected to this both of this flange, is called web. And thickness of this flange and web is T. Here you can see the thickness of flange and web is T, and all the dimension, which is height of this web and height of this flange, is also in terms of T. Here overall height is 5T, and the height of this web is 3T, and the thickness of web and flange is only T. So, and the base of our connecting rod I section is 4T. Here, let's repeat once again. Overall height of this connecting rod is 5T. Overall base of this connecting rod cross section area is 4T. Height of this flange is 3T, which is subtracted by thickness of this flange, and thickness of web also is T. Yeah? So you have cleared about this, the dimension which we have considered. Now the question is this, how we have considered this dimension? These are standard dimension which are applicable in any kind of connecting. So while designing this kind of connecting rod, you should always remember this is standard dimension which can be applicable in each and every dimension connecting rod you are dealing with. Here, if it is IC engine, diesel engine, or it is petrol engine, or any type of engine, if there is connecting rod, then you have to consider this kind of standard dimension. Okay, so these are the standard dimension for your connecting rod. Then the cross section area of the connecting road. Let's discuss about the cross section area of the connecting road. So what will be our cross section area for the connecting road? So connecting road's cross section area, here you can see total area of this flange and web. Here there are two flanges and one web. So ultimately cross section area will going to be like this: area of 2 into flange plus area of web. So what could be the area of this flange? Flange area will 40 into t, because base is 40, it's rectangular area. So base is 40 and thickness is t. Here, and what is the thickness of our, what is the area of our this web? So web height is 3t only. Here you can see 3t, height of web is 3t. Here, and thickness of web is t. So it will be 3t into t. So 3t square and 4t square. So summation of that will going to be our final area. So what will be our summation of both of these? So here you assume this, here we have calculated the area of the flange, which is 40 into 2, which is 40 square, and there are two flanges, so that's why 2 into 40. So ultimately 8t square, it's the area of flange, plus 3t square, which is area of web. So ultimately cross section area of this connecting road will going to be 11t square. So just remember this, cross section area of connecting road will going to be 11t square. Clear? Then the length of the connecting road, clear? Total length of our connecting road, which is from center of eye of our small end and center of the eye of our big end, that will be area of connecting road. After that, the yield stress, which is compressive stress. Clear? Compressive stress, what is compressive stress? Compressive stress will mainly dealing with your connecting road when it is comes under short column theory. So for this compressive stress, we are going to determine the working stress or working load on this component while considering Rankine's compressive theory. So our connecting road will subjected to compressive stress, which is defined by Rankine's theory. This connecting road is subjected to compressive stress, and then after it will connected subjected to different types of stresses. And the load which is generated due to this compressive stress, it is called buckling load. And this buckling load will going to determine our cross section. We have to determine our cross section area which can withstand this buckling load. Okay. After that, we have to design this for our limiting criteria for, because due to this buckling load, it can be tend to buckle into x-axis direction. Here you can see x-axis cross-section area and y-y direction. So it can be buckle at the both the direction. We have to find that minimum moment of inertia where it can be yield easily. Okay? This is the radius of gyration which we can be it can be applicable in while considering this moment of inertia. So these are going to be our input criteria. After that, let's got into our design of this dimension of this connecting road. First of all, as we have told, as I have told you, we have to find buckling load at x-axis and buckling load at y-axis. At x-axis, clear? In last slide, we have seen that at x-axis it will be comes as a ixx, clear? And it at the y-axis it will be iyy. So according to this ixx and iyy, we have considered kxx, which is radius of gyration, and kyy, whichever is higher, we will going to design the pair on for that only. Clear? Because the higher the load, it will try to buckle on that cross section also. Clear? So here you can see this is the equation: sigma c into a divided by 1 plus a into L upon kxx square, where L is total length, kxx is radius of gyration, sigma c, which is compressive stress, a is cross section area, small a, which is constant depending on different types of material. Clear? In the case of mild steel, it is 1 upon 7500. In the case of wrought iron, it is 1 upon 9000. And it is in the case of cast iron, it is 1 upon 1600. Here you can see how it going to be buckle in the direction of xx direction and yy direction. Clear? After determining both of this load, we have to consider this k, what will going to be kxx and kyy. For that, we have to determine our ixx and iyy. Here you can see ixx and iyy. For ixx, we have to design, how you are going to consider this ixx to design this IX6, we have to consider I section from horizontal plane. Here you can see from horizontal plane. Here in previous slide we have talked about horizontal plane. Like let's get back to this previous slide. Here you can see in from horizontal plane. If I want to find out moment of inertia from horizontal plane, I can consider this a cross section area, which is I section, as a whole, a full rectangle. Then subtract this two rectangles, smaller rectangles. So total rectangle will going to be a moment of inertia for this total rectangle will going to be I BD cube by 12, where B is base, which is 40, and D, which is depth, which is height here, which is 5D. So B, which is 40 into 5D cube by 12, minus these two cross section area. So let's go back to that slide. In that slide, we have talked about this thing. So in this case, you can see 4T into 5T cube minus 3T into 3T cube. So that is subtracted area from that total overall R rectangle. Clear? And that is 419 by 12 T raised to 4, which is our IXX. And from IYY, we have to consider it from horizontal side. So it is totally moment of two flange plus web. Clear? So for two flange, clear, flange area to, for two flange, 2 into 1 upon 12 T into 40 cube, because its base is 1T and its depth is 40. And in case of this web, it is depth is 1T and base is 3T. So ultimately, it is 131 by 12 T. And here you can see higher the value, it try to buckle on that side. Clear? So our connecting will try to buckle at XX direction. So in each and every design consideration, we have to find out what could be the more at where it will experience more moment of inertia. So higher the moment of inertia, it will try to it will tend to buckle at that direction only. So in this case, it is IXX. In normally, in each and every case, it will going to be only XXX. After that, we are going to determine this this for our bending equation. So bending stress WB will be buckling load, clear, sigma C divided by A 1 plus A 1 upon L upon KXX. Why KXX? Because of we have found out that it is trying to buckle on XX direction rather than anything. Clear? Okay, so we have clear about this design procedure of this cross section area. In what we have considered, two direction. One is IXX and IYY, where IXX is higher compared to IYY. So we are going to design depending on XX direction. In this case, WB will be our load, which is called buckling load. Sigma C is compressive stress. A, which is cross section area. Here we have found out that is 11 T square. Clear? 11 T square. A will going to be R depending on material. So K is nothing but I is equals to under root KA square. So ultimately K will going to depend on our I. Clear? After that, we are going to design small end and big end. After designing this connecting roads cross section area, we are going to determine small end and big end. For a small end, what is small end? Here I have shown you a small end. In small end, there is a bush. Bush is provided at the connecting rod or piston pin. So your piston pin is lying inside this small end. Here you can see this bush and the piston pin. So ultimately, this piston pin will try to create a bearing pressure on our connecting rod. Clear? This end. Then after it is big end. Big end is connected with our crankshaft, or it is also called crank end or crank pin end. Clear? So our design will relatively depending on this crank pin design. So let's design consideration of this crank pin. So before getting into this, we should understand force exerted by gas pressure will going to directly affect this designing of crank pin and our big end at small end. Piston pin and crank pin. So for that, we have to determine this gas pressure. Gas pressure is nothing but pressure generated by gas blasted or gas generated in your piston cylinder cavity. So here you can see This FL, which is gas pressure force, FL is equal to pi d raised to 4, where d is diameter of your piston, p is pressure generated by piston. So FL is equal to pi d raised to 4, pi d square by 4 into p. So this is going to be act on your piston pin. And due to this force, your piston will pin will become under lateral force, which is also called a bearing stress in this lateral area. So there will be rubbing effect between your piston pin and small end and crank pin and big end. So that will create a bearing pressure. So here we have considered allowable bearing pressure for crank pin as well as piston pin. So this is DC is diameter of crank pin, LC is length of crank pin. Here you can see. Here for the same on the same criteria, this is diameter of piston pin, length of piston pin, and bearing pressure of piston. So here we have determined the projected area under this crank pin and piston pin. So for the projected area under crank pin, it is diameter, which is a rectangular section, which is diameter into its length into bearing pressure. For the same, for this piston pin, it is diameter into length to bearing pressure. So this will going to be our design of piston pin at a small end and a big end. So here the design is purely depending on bearing pressure rather than anything else. Clear? After that, we are going to determine this force which is acting on our piston pin and crank pin. So this is force at piston pin and force at the crank pin. Here we are talking about also a dimension, different types of dimension of this relationship between the dimension of the piston pin. Here you can see that length of crank pin, it is 1.25 times of length of diameter of the crank pin. At the same time, here in the case of piston pin, it is 1.5 times of diameter of our crank pin. Clear? Okay, so after this dimension, we are going to design size of bolt of our big end cap. Clear? So these bolts are subjected to shear stress. Clear? How this shear stress going to act? Shear stress going to try to shear out our bolt. So our bolt will going to be find out at a cross section area, which is pi by 4 d square, which is diameter of our bolt. So the force which is experienced by this bolt, it is our reciprocating force. You have study about this reciprocating force in design of machine, or you can say DOM, which is reciprocating mass force generated due to reciprocating mass, which is FL is equal to MR into omega square into R into 1 plus R by L. Clear? Where R is radius of that crank. Clear? L is length of our connecting rod. Clear? Omega is RPM, or you can say angular velocity of your connecting rod, and MR, which is mass of your reciprocating component, which is in kg. So first of all, you are going to find this force generated due to reciprocating mass, which is going to directly act on your bolts which are try to shear it out. Clear? After that, we are going to find equations for this our connecting rod cross section area. So this force which is generated due to our reciprocating component will directly try to shear out our component, or you can say bolts. Here, so bolt diameter of bolt is dcb and its tensile strength sigma 3, which has its shear stress. Clear? Number of bolts. So there are two number of bolts. So ultimately we can find out diameter of our bolt if we have this force and stresses. Clear? Okay. And then you can find out nominal direction or diameter or major diameter. After designing of this belt, we are going to design thickness of big end cap. Now this big end cap is subjected to a bending stress. Why bending stress? This big end cap will going to act as a simply supported wing, which is supported at two end, which are at bolts, and loaded at a center. So our big end cap will going to act as a simply supported beam, and this simply supported beam will directly affected by gas pressure as well as pressure, bearing pressure generated by our crank pin, because it is at a crank pin place. So here we have to find out this moment which is generated at the center, the distance x, which is x from one end. Clear? So moment at the center will be F1 into X, where X is a distance from our bolt center. Clear? Distance from the bolt center. So what is that? So what is that going to be your big end diameter of the big end bearing plus 2 into thickness of that bearing plus 3, which is clearance. Clear, so that will going to be here. I have in this image, you can see that the distance between bolt center and our center, where B is the width of your big end cap from the this from that side direction. You can see the thickness of that, and this is allowable bending stress for our big end cap. So ultimately, from this moment, we can find out equation of section modulus. How you can find out the section modulus? M by I is equal to sigma upon y, where sigma upon I by y is equals to your section. So section Z is equals to force or a moment divided by stress. So here you can see moment divided by stress will going to be your sectional modulus. So ultimately stress will be moment divided by sectional modulus. Here moment is F1 into X divided by 6, which is F1, which is generated by that's a reciprocating mass, and Z is it is from that section 6 upon BC, which is B is base of this big end cap and thickness of big end cap. So ultimately you can find your thickness of this big end cap. Clear? So this was our design consideration or design procedure for connecting rod. Clear? I hope you can you have understand it very well. We have designed this component into 5 parts. One is its cross section area, another is big end and small end bearing, and third one is to find out this dimension of bolt, and ultimately we have find out dimension of big end cap. I hope you have understand this very well. If you have any doubt regarding any of the section of this part, you can directly contact me or ask me. Thank you so much. I am ending this procedure here. Thank you.